Hey everyone, welcome to this week's Azure Infrastructure Update. It's the 24th of March and a pretty quick update this week. There's a big thunderstorm going on, so if you hear a bit of thunder, all good. As always, I have the chapters, so you can jump to a particular update you care about the most. New videos this week, I created a video diving into dynamic groups, what I can do with them, how I should use them to get the most impact from them. And then just a really quick video about the snipping tool and clipboard history that I started to play around with on a new Windows 11 build I did, and it's really powerful. So I wanted to just share that combination and how easy it is to use. As we get to the new updates, so if I have ASP.NET applications and they're running on a IIS 7.5 and above web server, then what I can now do is very simply and in a bulk way, through a PowerShell script, I can migrate them to Azure App Service. So I can use these PowerShell scripts to discover, assess, and then migrate these .NET web applications to an app service. This could be from anything. It could be a Hyper-V VM, a VMware VM, some other thing. But as long as it's running on that IIS 7.5 and above web server, I can then perform that migration in bulk to Azure App Service. It even can package them up so I could move to some alternate server for different types of migration scenarios. If I have some large scale migration of a huge number of ASP.NET based web apps, I can now use these PowerShell scripts they provide to help me do that. And then API management now has workspaces. So Azure API Management is this fully managed service that if I have various APIs on various services I have, enables me to publish them, secure them, transform requests to that API endpoint to then map it to something on that receiving service. I can monitor. So I have all these capabilities with Azure API Management. But what I can now do is create a workspace. So I can put specific APIs in this workspace, and then that workspace can have its own role-based access control, for example. So I can give specific groups of people permissions only on the APIs within a certain workspace. Then also, API management now has private link support. So that's GA. So private link, remember, lets me have an IP address in my virtual network that communicates to a specific instance of a service. So in this mode, that private endpoint will talk to the gateway associated with a specific API manager, and I could then turn off public access. I'll only be able to access it where I have these private endpoints, and of course, any network connected to the virtual network with the private endpoint. This is gonna work on all of the SKUs. So developer, basic, standard, premium, whereas I think the other types of network integration only worked with the developer and the premium SKUs. So this is a new capability available. On the networking side, so for App Gateway, remember App Gateway is the regional layer 7 load balancer, understands app rules, I have the networking capabilities. Well, it also now has TLS certificate management in the portal. If I go and look at the certificates management now, I'll see a new listener SSL certificate tab. So for the listeners that receive that traffic, I can now go and manage, I can import specific certificates and then see the listener it's associated with. So it's just given me now a portal-based way to do that certificate management and the listener associations. Traffic Manager now has reserved labels. So Traffic Manager, remember, has some name.trafficmanager.net. And I can have child names of that. So if I had saviltech.trafficmanager.net, well, let's actually see this, it's easier to see. So if I jump over to here, in my example right now, I've got a Traffic Manager, and you can see the name is saviltech.trafficmanager.net. Now I could create other traffic manager profiles that is a child. I could do child.saviltech.trafficmanager.net. And in the past, there was no protection. Some other Azure AD tenant could go and create child.saviltech.trafficmanager.net, but that is no longer now allowed. So if I have created saviltech.trafficmanager.net, it's now reserving that label and any child label specifically for my Azure AD tenant. So if you now went to your tenant and you try to create child.savviletech.trafficmanager.net, you would get a conflict, it will fail. So that's now just built in, it's gonna happen by default. So if you wanna use Traffic Manager, go and create that base label for your company, and then that's gonna make sure no one else can create child labels of that in their own tenants. So that's a GA feature, so go and lock that in. And then Virtual Network Manager has gone GA. So I did a whole deep dive video on Virtual Network Manager when it was in preview, but the functionality has not changed. So I recommend you check that out. So it gives me different types of functionality. I create these groups of virtual networks. And then once I've created those groups, I can do both connectivity. So I can describe, hey, I want a mesh connectivity. I want a hub and spoke. But I can also configure security admin rules. And again, this is all centralized. And one of the great things about those security admin rules is if I think about there's a flow of traffic, I can create these security admin rules as part of the virtual network manager. Well, in those rules, I can do various things. So obviously I could do deny. So if I do deny, it's just gonna kill it straight away. I could do allow. Now, if I do allow, then the traffic is allowed to continue on to the NSG that is linked to the subnet or maybe even the NIC, and then only then if it's allowed would it carry on to the destination. But I can also do always allow, which is really nice because maybe I've got some types of traffic, connectivity to domain controllers, connectivity to patching services. I don't want some local person to accidentally disable. So now I could create these security administration rules as part of my virtual network manager, apply it en masse, force these always allow rules, and then if there's other types of traffic I want to leave up to the local NSG, I just allow it, and then it's gonna funnel through, and then that will make a decision. Or maybe there's a zero-day vulnerability and I want to kill that traffic. Again, centrally, I could set it to deny. It will never even make it to that NSG, so I can kill it straight away. So again, Virtual Network Manager, really, really powerful for both the defining centrally the connectivity, but also those security administration rules. So it gives me a lot of great capabilities around that. On the storage side, so now we have encryption scopes for storage accounts that have had the hierarchical namespace enabled. We think of it as a data lake V2. So encryption scopes, let me say, hey, instead of just setting a, for example, a customer managed key for the entire storage account, encryption scopes let me use different keys for different containers, so a portion, or even specific blobs. And that could be both a customer managed key or a Microsoft managed key. This is useful. Imagine I'm running some service and I have different customers' data. With an encryption scope, I could use a different encryption key for each different customer's container, for example. So they've got different encryption between those customers. Well, now if I'm using hierarchical namespace, so the data lake, I have that same capability to use different keys for the encryption for different containers or blobs. And again, it can still be different Microsoft managed keys, I just need a different key, or it could be a customer managed key, I want to control the key in my key vault. So that functionality, hey, we now have it for the data lake. And of course, any service that uses that hierarchical namespace, some of the more advanced features like the SFTP, the NFS, they rely on that hierarchical namespace, so those would then benefit from being able to have these different encryption keys at those scopes. On the database side, so Azure Data Explorer, the very large scale data ingestion analysis service, now has Serilog sync ingestion. So Serilog is this very popular logging framework for .NET applications. It allows me as the developer to control exactly the log statements that are going to be output to the service, and it's designed for structured event data specifically. So now I can actually take ingestion directly from that Serilog sync from my .NET applications. And in Service Bus, now can use Azure AD-based authentication with JMS 2.0. The huge benefit here is that obviously Azure AD authentication is also used for managed identities. That could be both a system or user-assigned managed identity. So now a service running in Azure that has a managed identity can now directly integrate using its native token. I don't have to worry about secret management to my service bus when I'm using JMS 2.0. So that's the big deal there. And in miscellaneous, Azure AD now has custom claims providers. If I have some target application, and Azure AD creates a token, and that token has various claims in it, what I can now do is I can configure a custom claims provider. This uses an extension that when it's going to go and create that token, it will call the extension. The extension will then go and talk to a RESTful API I create. So I'm responsible for creating that RESTful API that it's going to go and query. And what it will do is it will send that RESTful API a JSON payload with information about the user, for example, and some other data. It'll have an OAuth bearer token for the authentication to that RESTful API. Then the RESTful API can do whatever it wants. It could talk to an LDAP service. It could talk to a SQL database. It could talk to, it doesn't care. We don't care at all as Azure AD. It goes and does something, then it's going to return some claims to our custom provider, and then we can pick which of those we want to add to the token that we send to the target application. So all of this now means that we can add custom claims to the tokens that Azure AD generates for specific applications. And that was it. As always, I hope you found this update useful. Until the next video, take care.